Hi, my name is Tidenay Bradley. I am a research scientist here at SandboxAQ, and today I'm very happy to be here with Martin Ganahl, who is senior staff scientist working on large quantitative models here on Sandbox. And so today, Martin has joined me to talk about some new work that's come out. So Martin, thanks so much for your time today.
Absolutely. Excited to be here.
So I just want to kind of jump in and not bury the lead, because in a series of two new papers that have come out recently, you, along with researchers at Sandbox, here at Sandbox, at NVIDIA, at a few international research institutions, you've made advancements in quantum chemistry that were just out of reach a few years ago. So just starting from a high level, can you tell us what are the main problems you and your collaborators were working on, and how did you go about that?
Yeah, absolutely. So this work that we've been pursuing for the past roughly 2 years now is, as you said, focusing on quantum chemistry. So quantum chemistry is about understanding how molecules or how atoms interact with each other to form molecules, and how molecules interact with each other to form larger compounds from a quantum mechanical perspective. So using the fundamental laws of quantum mechanics. And the methods that we have developed here are tackling that problem. So from, people call this ab initio, meaning that without any prior knowledge, just starting from the bare laws of quantum mechanics, you try to make predictions about how certain molecules form, how they behave, how they interact with each other. So this is sort of the setting. This is an extremely challenging problem. And depending on which type of molecules you're interested in, can be daunting, a really daunting task. So the methods we are developing are sort of tackling that type of problem.
I see. And you have two papers that have come out to sort of tackle this, maybe in two different directions. Can you tell us a little bit about each of the methods in your 2024 paper and the one that came out this year in 25?
So those two methods are actually, so the second paper that we published recently builds on the work that we published in the first one. And what we've done there, or the work has, what we put forward is a special type of algorithm that is designed to tackle the most challenging problems in quantum chemistry. These are so-called multi-reference systems, systems that some people call them strongly correlated molecules. These are systems that are very hard to treat with any existing numerical method, basically. So what we are, or we have developed and shown in this paper, is that we're focusing on a very specific type of algorithm called tensor network algorithm, specifically something called density matrix normalization group, which is a very successful and very powerful algorithm that people have developed over the past 20 years. So we looked at this type of algorithm and how this can be applied to this type of problem, solving quantum chemistry problems. But not only that, so a key element in this work has been the acceleration on GPU hardware. So this algorithm that we are exploring there is kind of like a very compute intensive method, but also very accurate. So, but to get it to, you know, to solve these very, very challenging problems, you really need to get a lot of juice out of it. So we were exploring how to combine like large scale compute with this very high performance or highly accurate, but also highly complicated algorithm to sort of solve these types of problems.
Yeah, no, that's exciting. So I'm curious to maybe just dive a little deeper. Can you just a little more specifics? What is it that your team and you did differently to get such a huge leap in this direction?
So I think the real advancement here has been a way to schedule these types of computation. So this is a very, solving these types of problems requires a lot of linear algebra, complicated linear algebra, and getting that to run very, very fast on GPU accelerators is extremely challenging. So the team here has done a fantastic work, and there's actually also other work, previous work on which this work is building, to really, you know, scale those types of calculations up to these clusters and the hardware that is accessible now through these advancements in AI and machine learning. So to scale it to these systems has this kind of a big challenge. So this is one of the things that this work is sort of has shown, that you can actually use this hardware to do these types of calculations extremely efficiently.
So actually thinking about efficiently, do I think efficiently in terms of greater accuracy and speed? Is that some of the improvements that you all saw?
So it is indeed. So I think the biggest advancement is speed here. And with speed comes accuracy. So so there's this there's a lot of hyperparameters you can tune in these algorithms. Yeah, and I can go into the details about that, but without like getting too technical here, but there are certain parameters in these algorithms need to be scaled up to get very, very high accuracy. And as you scale these parameters up, the computations become much more expensive. So to be able to reach a certain level of accuracy, you need to go to a certain level of, you know, you need to scale that parameter up, and that costs a lot of compute time. So you really want to be able to make very, very good use of GPUs in this case, because they will help you to massively, you know, reduce the time it takes you to get to an answer.
So I wonder, just for the folks that are in the know, can you tell us about some of the benchmarks that you all ran? I know that there were certain molecules or enzymes that you focused on specifically. Can you talk a little bit about that and sort of the relevancy or the application?
Yeah, certainly. So the molecules we looked at, one of them is called cytochrome P450. So this is, in fact, actually a large enzyme. So cytochrome is a protein that has a metallic, also has an active site that contains a metal complex. And this molecule plays a very important role in the human body. It's I think, in the liver. So it's responsible for metabolizing substances in the liver, and for example, drugs. So there's a whole class of cytochromes. We were focusing on one specific one. And the active site of this molecule has this complex that has a metal and iron in it. And it's basically a catalyst. So what's happening is systems, you know, atoms come along or molecules come along. They kind of bind to this metallic site. And then there is a certain change happening, you know, an oxygen gets inserted into a certain bond. And that causes further downstream changes or metabolic processes. And these molecules are extremely challenging. So these are a typical multi-reference systems, or it's expected. So there's a lot of stuff going on, but if you look at one in this catalytic cycle, but if you look at one specific configuration, it is suspected that this is a multi-reference system, and people have looked at that in the past, and I think there is good evidence that one of these compounds is a multi-reference system. And understanding, so what one would like to do at the end is understand what type of catalytic processes these systems can metabolize or can cause, and that requires an understanding of the electronic structure. And so this is one of the systems we focused on because it's very challenging, but it's also very relevant for fields like drug discovery, biology in general. It's sort of at the sweet spot where you see it's extremely challenging to get, but it also, if you can solve these types of problems, they will have potentially large impact.
So actually, I want to think about that a little bit more, because just zooming out a bit, if I do work in pharmaceuticals or material science or clean energy, can you talk a little bit more about what can we do now better, faster with these tools and these discoveries that you all have made? Just speculating.
Yeah, absolutely. So in my mind, what this opens is a door to really unlocking certain novel systems or understanding of materials that are very challenging at this point to understand. And these include things like catalysts or other, or also materials like superconductors and these types of systems. So what one can do now is, and I mean, a lot of that is still, you know, it's not shown yet, but there is, I think, evidence towards that this is possible, that we can scale simulations up to sizes where that will allow us eventually to accuracies that will allow us eventually, hopefully, to get definitive answers to questions of electronic structure of molecules that are beyond the reach of what's possible within, you know, maybe hours or maybe days of calculations. These are things that may have taken many, many weeks, maybe months, even a decade ago. So this was I think this is a huge advance in terms of what you can do today. So you can think of starting to look at systems on a daily basis. You know, and a chemist might be able to investigate a number of different types of molecules in silico with this technique within a few hours, which might have taken them months, maybe 10 years ago. So I think that will eventually speed up this discovery process a lot in my mind.
So Martin, earlier you mentioned that you're working with these multi-reference systems. Can you just tell us why are these systems in particular so challenging to simulate for most of these standard computational methods?
Yeah, absolutely. So the special thing about these multi-reference systems, it's almost a tautology, because typically people define them as systems that are not so solvable with standard computational tools. So it's not a very satisfying answer, but at the end of the day, what makes them so challenging is that so there's different aspects around it, and they're sort of interplay. There's an interplay between them, and it's not always entirely understood. But what you observe in many cases is that the electronic structure of these molecules, so there's energy levels in these systems, and these energy levels determine, or the spacings of these levels and how far they're apart from each other, determines the chemical properties of the molecules. And in many cases, these types of systems have very, very narrowly spaced energy levels at the bottom. So the ground states of these systems are sort of have, so there's almost a density of states at the ground state level. So there's just like a ground state, but then there's only with a very, very small gap, maybe a few or many other states. And that makes most systems, so if you try to solve, typically you're interested in a ground state, and trying to solve a system that has that property, often so the methods can get confused about which thing is the ground state actually, and then they struggle a lot. And because even though the systems, these states may be very close in energy, they may still be very different in terms of other properties. So this means that even if you get it, it's not like you don't care so much. You really have to get to this energy, right? Even if you're just a little bit away from the energy, the state may be different, small difference in energy, but it can still be significantly different from other aspects. So it is very important to get that right. But this sort of causes a lot of trouble for many of these methods. And it's also, I will say that DMRG is also not a silver bullet in that sense. So it is still challenging to get it, but it offers a very unique way of approaching the correct answer in a systematic fashion that many other approaches don't have. So I think that's another really, really great benefit of this approach.
Yeah, I mean, this sounds like a really significant breakthrough. So congratulations to you and your collaborators on this work. Maybe just wrapping up, can you tell us a little bit about the next steps or some other problems or challenges you all are tackling these days?
So I think what this technique, like going to, this also like kind of an extension of to your last question, where do we think this can go next, mm-hmm. right? What is coming here? I think that these techniques, and specifically tensor networks, are still at, you know, there's still a lot to explore in this area. Specifically with this direction, I think what I'm excited about is like looking at how these tools can be used to as a combine them with data-driven approaches, because I think one of the big challenges that I'm seeing today in material, like in machine learning for materials, is getting accurate data for training machine learning models. So I think like the whole world is really excited about this, like these breakthroughs and this like extremely fast pace at which the field of AI is moving. But the challenge with material science, and in particular with these types of systems, is that the amount of data that is out there to train these models is really, really small. And it's extremely challenging to get it. So there is a lot of opportunity. First of all, so if you don't do it right, you will get basically poor data to train your model on, and that has implications of what the model can do. So you need to do it right. But doing it right is extremely challenging. So I think these types of technologies open an avenue to getting to a point where we can start to think about producing highly accurate data at a scale that has been impossible before. And that type of data could then unlock further developments for, you know, machine learned force fields or density functional theory to be applicable to a much broader class of problems than it has been so far. So this is what I'm kind of excited about.
Yeah, no, that actually sounds thrilling. It's an exciting time to be here at Sandbox and to hear about the progress your team is making. And it sounds like your two new papers are a significant step in that direction. So I'm excited for what's ahead. And thank you so much for taking time to chat today.
Absolutely, Titan. It was great chatting with you.